God, I thank thee that I'm not as other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, and even as this hunter. And this is what he says, and I fast. Amen.
I'm going
to finish reading this while Pastor gets ready. And he says, and I fast twice a week and give tithes of all of my possessions. And the publican stood far off, would not lift up as much as his eyes unto heaven, but smote his chest, his breath, and said, God, be merciful unto me. Details coming later.
All right.
Touch on
is as we go to Matthew chapter 14 and verse 22. We talked on this morning, but the disciples were told, constrained, to get into a boat and go to the other side. And part of that was that they were going to run into a tempestuous sea. And so there at this moment in time when, after great victories, we celebrate great victories of Jesus in this passage of chapter 14 of Matthew's Gospel. He had fed the multitude of 5,000 people. He'd taken the two fish and five barley loaves, and everybody was full. And everybody had a great time. And everybody said, let's make him king. And they were ready to take him by force. So as we raise the curtain on chapter 14, verse 22, Jesus is saying, no. I will not step out of my time period for serving God to please man.
Okay.
I will not, if you will, let the cries of the people come upon me so that they draft me to become someone I'm not ready to become at this time. So it is a moment in time, I think, when we all are, if you will, attacked with pressures and desire. But Jesus kept his focus on God. And I like to see kept the tempo and kept the pace by telling the disciples, you get in the boat and you go away, because until you go away, the people are going to mill around and want to take me and make me king, and I'm not ready to be king. So that's the way it opens. And so it's a moment in time when Jesus would take them and put them in a boat and say, you go across the sea and I'll meet you later. But he knew it was going to be a storm. And this brings us to an interesting point. Does Jesus put us in storms?
Amen.
I mean, we wonder, how did all this come about? Was one of my favorite two sermons, minding my own business. And all of this started happening to me. Job was minding his own business, wasn't he?
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, he had sickness. He lost his children. He lost his wealth. He lost his health. He lost everything. And he had a reason to be upset by our standards. But God was taking even Job through a storm. And Job had plenty. And so in those moments in life, it's a roller coaster. We have highs and we have lows. We have happiness coming into Christmas and we have some anger coming out of it. Amen? We want to remain constant with our Lord at all times. Amen? So I think I'll hold that off just a little, Brother Barti, and I'll move on to what I want to get to, and then I'll close out with that. Let me put it this way. I have some fascinating things you're going to see. Amen?
Right.
But right now I want to get to the passage in Matthew. And the fascinating things you'll see later is the fact that we miss so much of Christ by just focusing on the tradition and what we know. Because what we know can be put in a thimble compared to what God is. And we really don't explore more to know more. Amen? So you got to love the Word of God. And you got to love learning the Word of God. And you've got to apply the Word of God daily so that you are carrying on your life in such a manner when it comes your turn to die, you have fulfilled your mission on earth. That's a great feeling, but only few people experience. And then, not only have you fulfilled your mission, you know that you know you're going to the presence of God. That is a gift that is given by Jesus that you do not earn. And most of us want to hope we get there. Most of us want to believe we can do enough to get there. But it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. God has gifts upon gifts upon gifts. And when John the Revelator sealed up some things he didn't write, it was because God said, I don't want them to know it. If they knew all that was up here, it would tilt the scale on them coming here just to get. I want them to love me out of their own heart. I want confession to be made with the mouth, belief in the heart, and I want that portion of them to elevate. Then I will bless them as they graduate into the next dimension of living. And that's what Jesus gave us. Amen? More than a baby in a stable. More than we could ever know. Let's go now to Matthew chapter 14, verse 22. And then we're going to back off, as Captain Kirk likes to say, 500 kilometers. And see what the other side looks like. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Let's go to Matthew chapter 14. Do you have it now, verse 22?
Yes.
Now, Father, we thank you now for the power and efficacy of your word, for how the word can be integrated into our hearts and through our lives and be the difference maker in our thoughts, the difference maker in our achievements, the difference maker in just how we treat people. Slow us down. Fill us up. Use us, O God, in a magnificent and mighty way. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, our Father. We thank you, Lord. There is no shadow of turning with you. Now open our understanding and our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. Now let's narrate back to the story where Jesus has fed the multitude of 5,000, if you will. Now he is telling the people, I'm not ready to be king. You should go home. All right? The Bible says in verse 22, and straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship. He's compelling them now. You all get in a ship. Get in a ship. We don't want to go. Get in there anyway. Until you leave, the people are going to disperse. All right? And to go before him unto the other side while he sent the multitudes away. In other words, Jesus was disbanding this whole group and this gathering. He didn't say, here's the benediction, now y'all go home. He had to disband them. They were so taken by that food, amen, and by the miracle that he did with two fish and five barley loaves, 5,000 men besides women and children, and then 12, just to show you, which a bag of chips is a likes like that, 12 fragments of, 12 baskets of fragments left. They were saying, can you imagine having eaten your catfish and your food, huh? And he says, and there's plenty more, George. And there's plenty more. You mean the 12? Yeah, you can get some more. Is that the way we think about it? But God was doing, Jesus was doing something to show he was the Son of God. That was a miracle, that they might believe. All right? Not that they might eat. And we would eat. Amen. Who wouldn't want to reduce their grocery bill by having fish made daily by Jesus? So Jesus had to persuade them by demonstrating. Now, he sent them away. And when he sent the multitude away, he went up into the mountain part to pray. And when evening was come, he was there alone. So after your great moments of happiness and joy, exhilaration and exuberation, you ought to have a moment. Let me just pray here. We've made it to another Christmas. We've had everybody come in. We've eaten our fill, and we've enjoyed the beauty of another Christian. We are just ought to pray. In fact, you ought to pray before you bless the food, because if you're Christian, you ought to do that. Amen? But even so, Jesus shows you after the successes, you need to still be in touch with prayer. Amen? Because what we do after eating a good meal, people will go out to shop, they go to the movies, they'll do a lot of things that are good, but you should pray before you go. I'm not saying don't go. Amen. All right, so Jesus was alone and getting in touch and in tune with God. I think the tempo of life can be set in your prayer life. You can write that one down. The tempo is like music, having a beat. And then a movement. You get in step with the steps of heaven when you pray. And if you don't get in step with the movement and the beat of heaven, you'll go off. Amen? Don't let us get a little money. Don't let us have won that lotto last night. Huh? We wouldn't be in Bible study tonight. Oh, I bet you. So Jesus demonstrates getting the power and the pathos of his love by getting down and praying. Now, he sends the disciples away while he's praying. They're in a ship. So they have this, but the ship was now in what? The midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. Jesus was praying, but they're in a storm. They've just gone from exhilaration of the miracle now to a storm. Why is it when we have the highs, we get the lows? Why is it, George, we can't get as happy and fulfilled like we want to be because we know something else is around the corner? That right? God tells us that. Amen. So here are the disciples in a ship, and they are in a storm, about to get into a storm again. Now the Lord had sent them through first storm, and that first storm we know Jesus was in the ship and on the ship. This storm, Jesus was outside the ship. Now the question on the first storm, would they know enough about belief and faith to deal with the first storm and to rebuke the storm themselves? That was the lesson. And they didn't. All right? They failed. Remember what they went and did to Jesus? They went and woke him up. Master, the sea is tempestuous and the waves are billowing. Carest thou not? Dumb question. Jesus, do you care that we perish? That's the kind of question Mary asked Jesus when she was in there cooking all that food. Is that right? Martha, rather, asked Jesus when she was cooking all the food. Mary was sitting at the feet of Jesus. Martha was in there slaving, and she had enough and said, Jesus, cares not that Mary's in here sitting on her duff? Huh? Is that what we would have said? Huh? And you talking to Jesus? He said, Martha. My mother was all the way out of sorts. She was out of tempo. She was out of timing. And she said, he says, Mary had chosen the good thing. Just one thing is needful. And that's to sit at my feet and be fed. Now, the disciples, on the other hand, they had not learned the lesson because they asked Jesus, carest thou not that we perish? Jesus had to wake up, get up, and rebuke the wind. And then he chastised them and said, oh, ye of little faith. Add that to the story because that's exactly what he did. He rebuked them. But now he'll give them another test. Test number two. Would they pass or fail? They failed again. They did like us. Huh? The Lord teach us something and we say, okay, I got it now, and go and fail again. Just to show you how ignorant we are about learning the things of God. We learn them and then we forget them. We learn them and don't use them. Someone said the mind, of course, is a terrible thing to waste. And then others say that that we don't use but 20% of our mind, 80% of our brain is not used. I don't know if that's true. Some experts say we do understand how to use it. We just don't know how to apply it yet. We absorb it, but we don't apply it. But whatever the case, the second time the disciples are on the sea, the wind is tempestuous and the sea is billowing, and they get afraid. Now, that's a good thing to get afraid sometimes, but he had already taught them the first lesson. They wouldn't remember that. They like us. So now they're afraid. Now, then we get to the part where it says, but the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. They wanted to go where they wanted to go, but the storm has something called a fury. And whenever you go through life, life has a fury just like a storm. And you wonder where events are coming from, where people's emotions have broken down, where the environment is beginning to change and emotion is swelling like a great windstorm is getting ready to blow up. That's a storm. And what the Lord was saying is, I am growing you and perfecting you through storms. I will use storms as my teacher to see if you have that one little point in your life where you rely on me and you look at me being greater than the storm. And most of the time, we, as the folks, little kids say, we trip out. We trip out. The storm is there. Oh, Jesus, what? I didn't do nothing. You know how we are. Job's, every last one of them. I haven't done anything to deserve this. God says, I'm going to try you. And the trying of your faith will bring patience. And patience will make you not ashamed. And patience will fit you for my kingdom. Do you want to get ready for my kingdom? And most of us say, I'm not quite ready yet. So Jesus gave them a storm, and then he put them in the midst of the storm, and now he would come in the fourth watch. Fourth watch, 3 a.m. to 6 a.m., when everybody is usually sleeping. Your deepest sleep, your in-rim sleep, your rapid eye movement sleep. If it's not deep, it's not restful, it's not repairing. The deepest part of your night is at 3 a.m. to 6 p.m. And so it's in that watch when Jesus would come. And they didn't recognize it. Are we so troubled by our storms, we can't see Christ? Everything that comes upon us, we magnify it. We get on a magnifying glass and exaggerate it. Or either it just hurts and we can't do anything but hurt. But Jesus would come in the midst of the storm. And then the disciples would see him and get even more afraid. Is that what it says? Jesus went on the sea at the fourth watch, walking on the sea. In other words, Jesus is demonstrating, I'm bigger than the storms in your life. I can walk on them. Do you believe I can? And do you even recognize that I can? Or are you just missing it because you're so busy lamenting and commiserating with your woes that you don't take the time to see me in the midst of the storm? I'm there. Because wherever two or three are gathered together, he says, I am. He's in the midst, in the middle, in the middle. They were there, the disciples were on the boat, and Jesus was in the midst of them even before he became physically seen. Because he was praying for who? For them in that storm. All right? Let me move on. And then when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, what does it say? They were happy?
They were scared.
They were scared. And why were they scared? They said it was what?
A ghost.
And they cried out for fear. Can you imagine the deacon boy crying out for fear? All the men that's supposed to be leading crying out for fear. That's what this was. Huh? Is that right? Screaming and hollering and crying? Whoa, it's a ghost! You know, they really believed in ghosts. So in those days, they for sure it was a ghost. And so their help was coming, but because of fear, they couldn't even recognize Jesus. Jesus is bigger than that ocean. And he had already calmed it. Now, if somebody was walking who had already calmed the ocean before, who stood up and said, peace be still, you have no reason to fear him. You know, he's the captain of the ocean. He can make the ocean behave. So if you recognized it was him, you know, that's Jesus. We're all right now. We're going to be all right now. But they were afraid because they couldn't see through their blinded eyes. They saw only their fears exaggerated. That's another thing. Nighttime will make your fears get even more exaggerated. You know, you can think of something at night and have a panic attack. And God has to calm you back down. Because you're just letting your mind go on and on and on and on. And it begins to exaggerate and it picks up your fear and plays back your fear. So you need a mind that is, the old folks say, it's a mind regulator, heart fixer, and a mind regulator. Is that what they said?
Yeah.
Come on there. Heart fixer and mind regulator. Meaning an unregulated mind is a dangerous mind. So these disciples were screaming with fear and everything, saying it's a ghost, it's a ghost. And one said it and all of them believed it, just like sheep, huh? But straightway, it would take Jesus speaking his powerful word into not only their ears, but into their understanding and their heart. And what was his word? Be of good cheer. It is I. Be not afraid. The first thing he was doing was telling them, you have no reason to fear. In fact, you ought to be happy. You ought to be happy is me. Is that right? You ever gone somewhere, gone home or something, somebody left the door open and you go in, and somebody said, I didn't know I left the door open. You say, you ought to be glad it's me coming in, and not a burglar. Jesus was coming in, and they ought to have been glad it was Jesus coming. And so now the word comes into play, because our mind is so excitable over the wrong thing. It's hard to calm people down and try to save them sometimes. That's why a drowning man sometimes has to be knocked upside the head, or knocked a little, so that you can carry him to the shore. Otherwise, they'll be fighting you because of the fear of the water and try to drown you in the process, climbing on you to sit on you so they can be like their own land. It ain't going to work that way, not in the properties of one. So sometimes people have to be knocked out in order to be saved. So Jesus would now rearrange their mind and say, be of good cheer. Fear not, it is I. And we know the rest of the story because the rest of the story was old Peter. Peter said, answered and said, Lord, if it be thou, still having his doubts. He wasn't sure. Look how the Lord meets us in our doubts. If it be thou. And the devil is the only one who likes to use suppositions. Is that right? Yeah. If thou be the Son of God, huh? Yeah. Isn't that what he said to Jesus in the mount of temptation? And command that these stones be made. Always if, a supposition. So here's Peter having his doubt and reservation. If it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water. And therefore Jesus said, I'm going to let that slide. Come. And Peter does what? Gets out of the boat. 200 and some, 6'2" fishermen, gets out of the boat, and the H2O that is normally soluble and liquid holds this man up at the word of God. The storm wasn't no problem, huh? When he can get out and walk on water, I don't believe any more problems when you walk in unsoluble H2O. God says, all of a sudden the song fails. I don't feel nothing. What are you talking about? I'm walking on this water. And so that was the power of his word. Now Peter, of course, walks out to go to him. And I believe the rest of them are still scared in that boat, not believing it's Jesus. They're still screaming. And I like to say taking bets on when Peter's going to sing. And now Peter takes his eyes off Jesus. And what happens? He begins to sing. He had faith. And as long as he looked at Jesus, he had the object of his faith in this field of vision, which I would call a spiritual trajectory. He had a faith like a rope, a tow rope, towing him. And as long as he kept looking at Jesus, he would tow him in. But the moment the devil gets into the storm again, makes the wind billow, makes the waves billow, makes everything seem tempestuous, Peter took his eyes off of Jesus and looked around to check things out. And that's when he lost his faith and began to sink. Because fear overruled his faith. Do you know we can get in a storm and know Jesus will bring us out and then go right back to fearing again? You have to tell some people, be quiet. Grandmama would say, be still. You ever heard that one? Be still. Lie still. Just be still and let the Lord work it out. And the Lord tells us in his own word, be still and know that I'm God. So storms come to test us. Peter did a good job of passing the test, at least initially, but then he looked back, in a sense, at the fear, and he became floundering, and then Jesus, in his floundering, he nearly drowned. How long does it take you to drown in the seawater that's colder than cold, and you get hypothermia, and you don't take long to drown? It's like a fly being in a big vat of Kool-Aid. He gonna die sometimes. Need a Kool-Aid is gone, but the fly is dead. All right, gotta make it over again. But here's the idea: when we get in that cold water, we can't live long. Peter had enough sense to holler, "Master, save me!" And you know that's all the Lord needed to hear. He needed to hear, "Master, save." Did you know Jesus already knew when Peter disappeared off the horizon he was gone? Do you think about that? If all of a sudden you're talking to somebody, boom. They're gone. Where are they? Where did they go? And Peter fallen into that water. But he hollered out in his distress. In his distress, he hollered out. And you know, those who call upon the Lord, he will in no wise cast them out. Had it been us, we would have let him in that water a little longer, Sister James, and said, now I told you. Why don't you go looking at him? We would have tried to teach him while he's in the water. Is that what we do? Let him stand there a little longer. Is that our thinking? Let him learn something. That's us. That's all the way from our daddies, our granddaddies, everybody. They let him in the water a little longer. Jesus goes out, picks him up, and then puts him in the boat, then teaches him the lesson. He saves him first. Isn't that a loving master? That when you make your mistakes, he doesn't exaggerate and beat on you? Because that's what man will do. Now the joy of this whole thing is that the Lord wanted them to understand he's more than the world against you. If Christ is for you, he's more than the storms that you're going to encounter. If Christ is in you and for you and with you, he wants you to know that. And the greatest thing we could do is refine our faith and focus more on Jesus. We do not take our faith and our mind to lift up to Jesus enough. We have the habits, and we have the traditions of Christmas, but we don't have the mindset that Jesus came here to give us. I've come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. Mm-hmm. Look at the time when, I'll close on this one because I don't have a lot of time, when Jairus' daughter was sick in the Luke 8th chapter, about the 41st verse. In that passage, Jairus' daughter is sick, he sends for Jesus, is that right? And Jesus is on his way to go. And he goes there, and the people, Jesus says, she's not dead, she's sleeping. And they laugh at him. They laugh at him. Especially when you had professional mourners. They had already been paid to come and cry. So they didn't want to hear that she was not sleeping. They had to get their money because they were going to do their crying. Is that right? Got to look at it that way. It had an economic side for them. So when Jesus said, she's not dead, she's sleeping. Oh, get out of here. Who's this crazy man? Jesus had to do what? Put them out.
Yeah.
Because he can't work where there's negative energy and where there's a lot of doubt. He put the doubters out, and then he raises the daughter and presents her to her parents. A powerful thing. All they had to do was believe. The centurion who had the servant that was sick, and he said, Jesus, I'm not worthy that you come under the roof of my house. I've killed a lot of folks. But I'm a soldier, and I know if you'll speak your words are marching in. My belief is such that I believe your words marching in can do the same thing you can do. And what did Jesus say? This is a centurion and a Roman. This is a Gentile, and he has more faith than all of Israel because he'd elevated his mind. He elevated his mind to believe the Lord through the storm he was going through. This is a crazy life we live sometimes. You think about a life, thinking about the seemingly contradiction of life. You live in order to die. And in the midst of living, you are dying. And earth is not what we think because earth is death row. Everybody who comes here doesn't leave until they die. So in the midst of living, we're dying. And so there's this moment in time when Christmas, I don't know if it is my last Christmas. Wonder what will happen next year in 2014 and 15, and will I be here again? We don't know that. So you got to take the storm and believe God wherever you are right now. God has you in his will. God has you where he wants you. All you got to do is hold to your faith and depend on his grace. You're not here to stay, but whatever you're here to do, do it now. Do it for the Lord. And live for Jesus. Because you won't have another opportunity. When you get to the next life, there are going to be times when you review this life and say, I messed up. I wasted time. I made a fool of myself. And the Lord said, look at all the time you wasted. You could have been doing something good and constructive. What were you doing? Sitting at your computer. Huh? Looking at TV. Plasma. High definition. 250,000 channels, huh? Look at how you spent your life. I didn't put you here for that. I got all that in the next world. And more. Amen? And we say, well, Lord, I'm so sorry I wasted that time. We're getting here. Life is just a small microorganism of existence. Just a little speck of existence to get you ready for eternity. And we got to use this time wisely. Now, we enjoy our family. Do that, please. Love your family and don't stop loving them till the Lord calls home. Amen? You make sure they're comfortable. Make sure that they're taken care of. But know for sureness when God calls them home away from you, where you can't do anymore, he has called them from labor to reward. And the thing I can't get over is God has such a reward. You know, it's nice to get invitations, isn't it? We get invitations to parties, get invitations. It's good to get invitations and get authentic, good invitations from good folk. Amen? But the invitation Jesus gives us, he said, I don't want nothing from this life coming into heaven. Somebody said, well, I heard Billy Graham say the other moment ago on TV. He said when John D. Rockefeller died, it was a big deal. Rockefeller died. All that money. And so they said, well, how much do they leave? You know, that's in a time. How much do they leave? And somebody replied, all of it. Because you can't. And you've never seen, as they said, a bank car filing a hearse. And you've never seen a U-Haul go filing a hearse. Whatever we have here, everything is going to be left. Isn't that amazing? Your nice clothes, your favorite pajamas, your slippers. And God said, don't bring none of that stuff. In fact, I am so intent that my heaven will be the perfect place. I don't even want your body here. Uh-oh. You got to take off your body and become spiritual, a celestial. I have to transform. You can't even bring your dirty body in my heaven. Because what I have is all new. You won't need cars. You won't need money. You won't need saturating you to another dimension of life. Let me close on this note, and then we'll bring out Clay again. I love in my spare time to read about physicists and what the physicists think about the world. I just love that. I'm just fascinated. Didn't take physics in high school, but I sure loved it. Einstein wasn't that great, even if he was a C student when he was at Harvard. But anyway, I'm not Einstein. I love to read it. And when I was reading about the string theory that they have about existence, is that the subatomic particles are not stable in this environment. Protons, electrons, things like that. They got to the point where they could see these things, and they would be disappearing, coming on and coming off, just like lights. And I said, what's happening? I thought the universe was made up of this, and why is it we can't fix the number of things that are subatomic particles? And the answer was, because those babies are going on another dimension from this world. They're in the next world and this world. Energy. Nothing but pure energy. When we get to glory, we won't have to worry about shaving our mustache and getting a haircut. Energy. That's what God will make us. And we will be able to go from one end of the universe to the next, whereas it takes all that speed of light and all those light years, we'll be able to just move. And faster than anything. We'll be able to exist. The beauty, I think, of going to the next world is that we take nothing with us except what we know about the Lord and love about the Lord. Is that right? You take nothing, certainly you take nothing out of this world but what you have in your essence of your heart for God. And then God makes you a new body, and he gives you all the things you used to say on the freeway. You don't have to say those anymore. Amen. Am I coming home to somebody? I'm trying to make it real. All the anger and animosity you used to get, getting ready to go to work, huh? Putting on this and that. No, we don't need that up here. You're going to have a new, whole new you. Isn't that amazing? Jesus brought us a new life. And that life is the ability to believe him at his word. It's not what we accumulate. I don't care, Bill Gates and all the richest people in the world. Whatever they accumulate, they're going to leave. Yeah. And they're wise to give it away now and to do something smart with their money to help the poor and get people vaccinated. But the idea of trying to get it all, and I was reading where the grandparents have accumulated more than $5 million in their retirement fund, giving it all away to their grandchildren because the grandchildren are finding it such hard economic goings and economic times, they're getting rid of their nest egg. Well, you can't take it with you. Huh? What good is leaving it, as the old folks say, to somebody you don't like? They say, I didn't want to get in that much. But it won't be. Hey, we paved the streets in heaven up there at this moment. And we don't even use this stuff. But we got our streets are better than the money market value of anything here. I'm just fascinated by that. Let's play play as he shows us. Mary, did you know? Did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water, had walked where angels tread? And I don't believe, I think it's a good question because we don't know the real half of who Jesus is. We know he's the Savior. We know he's the Son of God. That's all we need to know right now. But when we get to glory, we will know him and see him as he is. It will flip us over and knock us out. Run closer.
Water. Mary, do you know that your
Yeah.